Intel's new Alder Lake CPUs are here, and in this video I'm testing the 12700KF, which is the i7 chip, and I'm testing that against my 5900X to see, is this now the new king? Are the Alder Lake parts the recommended CPUs for Star Citizen? We've got Windows 10, we've got Windows 11, we've got hyper-threading, we've got E-cores off, we've turned it into an i5 to see what it performs like, and we've also got some VBS testing. All very interesting, let's get into it. Let's talk test setup, and as I do, some of the results will come up on the screen from the Windows 10 testing that I did. So, both systems have got a 3080 in them, they've got exactly the same RAM, 32 gigs of RAM, CL16, and they've also got the exact same NVMe drive model. So, in theory, the systems are as close as they can get to, both on Windows 10, as you see. And if you look at the results, you'll see the 12700KF is beating the 5900X pretty handily in most of these tests on Windows 10. And there's one interesting thing you might have noticed is that the 1% lows are significantly lower in some areas. So there is definitely something going on there, and as we get into the more extravagant and longer testing that I did, that will become clear. But on first glance, you have to say, it looks great. And I have to say, I was surprised. I thought this would slightly beat out the 5900X, but actually, in some areas, it really beats it quite handily. And yeah, as you'll see, as we'll get into it more. So it's a bit more fine-tuned, a bit more nuanced than that. But anyway, let's get into some more Lorville testing. So now here's where things start to get really interesting. We've gone to Lorville. This is where I've done the majority of the testing. I've done 20 runs for everything you see here, averaged out, pretty accurate results. So first of all, there we go, 5900X versus the 12700KF, and a significant win for the Intel chip. So it's looking good, but the story continues. So the next thing to do was to turn the E-cores off of the Intel chip. So these new Intel chips come with these E-cores, efficiency cores, which are lower power cores that don't clock as high, that basically are designed to run things in the background whilst your main thing is running. So in theory, things like streaming or maybe video editing, things going on in the background whilst you are playing a game, for instance. But Windows 10 doesn't really support them. The scheduler for them doesn't work. It's only really a Windows 11 feature. And so when you then turn them off of the Windows 10 runs here, you'll see a big increase in frames overall. But actually, if you look at the 1% lows, they have jumped right up. And stability then, all the stability issues that we're finding with the results before, where the 1% lows were really low and it's a bit laggy, they have been fixed effectively by turning off the E-cores. So that is very interesting. The next thing to then do is to look at Windows 11. So if we look at Windows 11 versus Windows 10, just stock with all the E-cores and everything on, you'll see that actually the performance has gone down overall, but the 1% lows have gone up. And again, the general experience was just much smoother here on Windows 11. Windows 11 knows what to do with the E-cores and it doesn't really get in the way of good performance. However, Windows 11 performance is down on Windows 10, so that's interesting. I then did another 20 runs with the E-cores off in Windows 11, and again, performance is slightly better this time than just the stock results for Windows 11, but nowhere near the increase that we saw with Windows 10. But interesting enough, and you have to make that decision if you buy one of these chips, whether you want to keep the E-cores on or off. There are reasons to keep them on, but maybe for pure gaming, you might want to turn them off. Next up, some hyper-threading testing. In the past, I found with the 5900X at least, that it performs better when you turn off simultaneous multi-threading or hyper-threading, same thing. And actually, the case here is that that isn't any. There's no good benefit to turning off hyper-threading with this Intel chip. I also had a quick go with turning this into the i5 model. So turning off two of the performance cores, and it effectively becomes the same thing. It won't clock the same and the cache will be different, and it looks as though actually turning the P cores off reduce the amount of cache available. I have to look at the data a bit more, but a few FPS less. I don't know if that would be reflected by using an actual i5, but that might be something somebody else will test, or maybe I'll get around to it one day. And finally, for my Lorville testing, I was really flagging by the time I did this, but the VBS testing. So virtual base security. This is a feature that has been available on Windows 10, but actually is default on in Windows 11 if you're building a new system. And it does have a fairly sizable hit to performance. So there are good reasons to have it on. It's extra security depending on the sort of work you're doing, whatever. But for gaming, it looks, or at least for Star Citizen, it looks as though there is a bit of a performance hit by having it enabled. So what to make of all that? Well, there's a lot. There's a lot to go through. Effectively, the first thing to say is that the Alder Lake CPUs have to now be the recommended CPU if you're buying a new system for Star Citizen. They are significantly faster than the current 5000 Ryzen chips, which were already very quick, Star Citizen-wise. But again, Ryzen will respond, AMD will respond with some fancy cache stuff that they're doing. That will come at some point next year, and again, that might come back up. But actually, these Intel chips are probably faster than I was expecting, so I don't know whether they'll meet them. But anyway, the recommendation probably be new system by Intel, this series. They're really great for start season. If you want the best performance, that's where to go. But realistically, if you're already on Ryzen, say you're on a Ryzen 2000 or 3000 CPU, the amount of money that costs to just move everything across to a new motherboard and everything, you'd be better off probably just upgrading to the 5000 series, unless you need absolute best performance. So that's that. Then it gets a bit more complicated. So Windows 10 is a mixed bag, because as I've said, the Windows 10 just flat, the processor left as it is with everything on that equals on, performs well, beats the 5900X, but it also is a bit of a stuttery mess. The 1% lows are not good, and it just, Windows basically doesn't know what to do with the E-cores. Windows 10 doesn't know what to do with the E-cores, and it just doesn't really work that well. So Windows 10, you take the E-cores off and you then get great performance, but whether that's practical for most people to turn the E-cores off, whether you've got other reasons why you might want them on, I think really, if you're going to go for this CPU, you're probably going to have to move to Windows 11. Because although we saw the results weren't as good as the Windows 10 results, they are generally more stable, and potentially CIG will be working on that as time goes on. Hyperthreading made no real difference. VBS is worth talking about, because VBS you want to turn off. And then really, if you're looking and talking about the actual line from the i9, i7, i5, they're probably going to perform pretty similarly, but in the testing we did, the i5 maybe will perform slightly worse, but we're talking a couple of FPS. I'm sure, again, it will beat out the Ryzen chips, so that could be a good choice as well. As I was editing this, I realised I hadn't mentioned DDR4 versus DDR5 at all, and in an ideal world, I'd actually ordered a motherboard for DDR5, and I'd ordered some DDR5 RAM, and the plan was to include that in this video as well, but there's just none in stock, so I couldn't get hold of any DDR5 RAM. But that will be something to look at in the future, and that will be something that's coming up. I guess as well, my personal opinion on this, I was expecting just to sell this system back on, sell it on, or do something with it. I wasn't expecting to keep it. I thought, well, it's not really much better than my 5900X system, but the performance at points was, it felt like a real game. I know that's a ridiculous thing to say, but I think this shows that actually, we're always waiting for tech from CRG to improve performance. So we're always talking about Gen 12, Vulkan, and whatever. But what this shows is that probably by the time the game is actually out, the hardware that we're able to purchase will probably be fast enough to run the game anyway. And I don't know whether that's been CRG's plan all along, is for development to be so long that eventually the hardware catches up with their ideas. But yeah, there was points where I was playing this and I was not dropping below 40 FPS, which is not something I've ever really seen in the cities before, and it felt like a real game, and performance felt really, really good. So I was a bit blown away by this. I was not expecting it to be that much better than the 5900X, but yeah, I'm probably going to keep this system now and convert it across and use this as my main system. That's probably enough for this one, but if you like this sort of stuff, this technical look at Star Citizen, please subscribe and like this video. That helps out a lot as well, and you can now even join the channel and support and become a member, which is wonderful. But there we go. I'll see you soon. Bye.